and Mr. Brian Kibler. But before we get too deep into you guys' thoughts on this game, we want to know what you at home think. Who do you think is going to win this last series? Maybe you don't know too well right now, but you just put it, take a guess out there. Whose name do you like better, right? Both of these names are a little bit difficult to spell, but you can use hashtag BunnyHopper, that's with an O, and hashtag Pokrovac, and have your say at home. Passing over to you guys. Raven, do you have any favorites in this matchup, knowing maybe these players a little bit better than the guys at home do at this point?
Yeah, it's a really tough one, actually, because both players have a background in competitive games from a very early age, so it's going to be really interesting. I don't know too much about their actual styles in terms of what decks they're actually going to bring specifically, but I'm sort of lean towards BunnyHopper a little bit, but these guys are both going to be pretty good. Brian,
I only learned of Pokrovac during the preliminary, but have been really impressed both by his play there and by the company he's kept. He actually prepared for this event with Stan Sifka, who's a player who has had a great deal of success in competitive games, both outside and in Hearthstone itself.
All right, we are ready to meet our players. So without further ado, let's meet the first of them, and it is Pokrovac.
So Pokrovac is from the Czech Republic. He's only 16 years old, but has already been playing competitive card games for 10 years, which I'm sure is longer than many of his much older competitors.
Right, that's crazy. Maybe even trying to follow in the footsteps of Amnesiac, as we saw in the Americas Championship, wants to be the new trial prodigy that we all talk about for the next few years. But let's move on very, very quickly to our second player, who is BunnyHopper.
Yeah, so BunnyHopper from Germany, he's another very intelligent player, but he completely admits straight away that he has a lot to manage in life. He has his school, he has Hearthstone, a few other social activities, things like that. So he fully accepts that he might not have all the time in the world he would want to commit to it, but he also knows that he's pretty good at the moment, and he's just going to see if he can continue and get better.
He actually prepared for both the preliminary and for this event with Diggin, who we just saw advance. So the two of them brought very similar lineups, and both succeeded at the preliminaries, clearly, because they're here.
Yeah, right.
So it'll be interesting to see if that preparation, even if he doesn't have the sort of full-time Hearthstone commitment, is able to pay off.
Yeah, we see the mix as well between a lot of these players have said, we've had some where it's like, I just practice on my own, do my own thing, and then the opposite end of that scale where players are like, no, like a team is super important, and having practice partners to sort of bounce deck ideas off and everything is like really important to the game.
Yeah, I believe Pokrovac was saying that he was testing with Stan Sifka for hours every day.
Yeah.
So definitely that kind of preparation can lead to some excellent results. We'll see if he can leverage that in this match.
Yeah, very interesting. To the dichotomy between the players who said they were more solo, more ladder-based solo grinders, and the team-based players that we've seen be very successful as well. But looks like your votes are in. Maybe some of those glowing words from Raven and Brian helped sway your decision here. But it looks like BunnyHopper is our favorite overall. So we'll see as the series develops whether we can check in on that. But I believe we'll be just about ready to take a look at the lineups here, maybe find out how the picks and bans are lining up. BunnyHopper, Warrior is banned, which leaves him with Druid, Paladin, and Warlock, whereas Pokrovac, his Warlock is banned, leaving behind the Priest, the Warrior, and the Paladin.
So Pokrovac is the only player in this tournament to bring Priest, and I actually saw a tweet from Stan Sifka earlier today saying that he was really excited to see that Priest deck in action because they worked very hard on it.
And also when you think as well, like, if he's been practicing so much with Stan Sifka and, they've basically built a deck they're both happy with, Stan Sifka kind of knows what he's talking about, right? So you've got to feel confident about a class that doesn't really show much representation in general. As we said, this is the only Priest where, as on the other hand, we've got BunnyHopper, who's taking like a super standard lineup in terms of classes, like Warrior, Druid, Paladin, Warlock, probably the four overall best classes in the game at the moment.
Yeah, I've heard that Stan Sifka knows a thing or two about Hearthstone, and there have been one or two niche appearances of Priest recently. I think Chess Dude brought it to the prelims, but interesting that he decided it wasn't good enough to bring to the tournament meta that he was expecting in the Americas Championship, whereas right here, Priest is deemed good enough. So really interesting stuff of the unique twists, as you said, against the more standard lineup overall. Which do you generally favor? Do you like surprising the meta, or do you just like going with the proven stuff?
Yeah, it's definitely a tough one. I kind of like trying to work against the meta to a certain extent, because the idea is that your opponents aren't going to pick the lineups and really prepare for something like Priest, just because no one's going to play it is the assumption.
Right.
If you prepare, even if you know one person's bringing it, you can't prepare for that. So there's definitely options, and you're open to maybe a bit of weakness when your opponent brings a deck like this. So very, very just on its own.
Yeah, I'm definitely much the same way. I prefer building my own decks, trying to target what I expect other people to bring. Interestingly, Pokervox said that was his plan in the preliminary. He actually specifically targeted Druid because he expected everyone at that event to play Druid, and he went 11-0 against Druid in the preliminary. That's an outrageous statistic.
That is crazy stuff. I was going to say, Raven, I know you're open to a little bit of experimentation with tournament lineups, having just watched you last night play a tournament with mid-range Shaman.
Hey, it was okay, and that was on your fault.
It was entirely
your fault.
My idea.
So
yeah.
I was pretty impressed. So I was like, I did a good ladder run with this deck. It seems to do well against everything that's being played. I was like, okay, I'll bring it. But if I lose, it's completely your fault.
All right,
I have my backup plan straight away.
Getting into the game here, we have Zoo versus Secret Paladin. This is a matchup that I personally favor the Zoo in quite heavily, but I've heard differing opinions. There's even been some money matches gone down between individual pros based on the win rates of these matchups. Brian, how do you feel about the matchup?
I generally feel that the Zoo deck is typically advantaged. It's able to get in the board faster, and that is typically where the Secret Paladin deck struggles. Secret Paladin is very good against other mid-range style decks, generally speaking, because it has this very powerful turn 4, turn 5, turn 6, obviously. But it can fall behind. It doesn't necessarily play well from that position.
Yeah, I think the Zoo's favored, but I think also, like, it's really important on who gets the board fill cards, gets the most out of them. So, like, the Implosion is going to be really key, and, like, how good the muster for battle is maybe with a Knife Juggler as well.
This is a terrible hand for Pokervox. He does have that muster for battle, but no plays prior to that right now. Hero powering isn't exactly what you want to be doing on turn two of an aggressive matchup.
Yeah, meanwhile, on the opposing side, Voidwalker into potentially Coin Imgang boss is an excellent start for the Zoo. 1-3 is just an excellent starting shape against Secret Paladin because of the expectation of things like Shielded Minibot and Muster coming out at some point. The only thing that really challenges it effectively is the Knife Juggler.
Yeah, and also the fact that you can coin into Imgang boss into another Imgang boss the following turn. That's pretty good. And like I said, a lot of this matchup is about how to fill the board, because they're both going to battle for the board control, right? That's how both of these decks really win. The Consecrate is going to be an important card, but even if he goes Buster into Blessing of Kings on one of the tokens on the following turn, it's really difficult, because although 5-5 is really good, you're trading against like so many different little minions against the Zoo. The full power of that 5 attack isn't normally getting too much value.
Yeah, the power overwhelming that we see in Bunny Hopper's hand is one of the big costs of investing that many resources in an individual large minion in this matchup. That's one of the advantages that Zoo does have against those mid-range decks, is it has lots of buffs, like power overwhelming, that is the most powerful among them, that allows you to punch through those big minions.
You're right, and Bunny Hopper taking his turn here with his turn 2, even though it seems like a pretty straightforward line of coining out the Imgang boss, but I like this. You know, this is a new situation for him, and even some of the most experienced players in the world really advocate this situation of, particularly early on in your first game, just take a moment on each turn just to acclimatize yourself with your surroundings, make sure you're comfortable. I don't think any play was ever going to happen that turn that wasn't coin Imgang boss, but Bunny Hopper just making sure he's comfortable in his environment.
Yeah, and it also has the knock-on effect of, maybe not all the time, but your opponent could be thinking, okay, so this guy's got quite a lot of options, actually, if he's, you know, sitting on turn 2 or 3 with, like, a coin. It's like, oh, maybe you could do like Peddler into something, or Juggler into a one drop, or, you know, so many different options that they're like, oh, okay. And then you do go with that Gang Boss, but then it's always in your mind, if he had so many options, he's definitely got a good follow up.
Yeah, it's also known as the Druid Bluff, right? Where you just sit there on turn 1 and just rope out. And it's like, yeah, I'm considering how to use these 2 Innovates and 2 Wild Growths that are in my hand.
Well, in many cases, too, you know, people will say, oh, you know, you're roping on this easy decision. It's like, well, you only get 90 seconds every turn.
Right.
So if you're thinking about, well, how is this going to play out next turn and the turn after that, and thinking about how the game is going to take shape in general, you don't have that extra time on later turns if you take a fast turn now. Yeah.
And also, like you mentioned this all as well, like, it's the beginning of the first set of this tournament. They're in a studio playing that. They've just sat down, gone into the game, and it's like, let's just, you know, relax, get comfortable, and then carry on from there.
Now, we have seen the Consecration be drawn here from Pokervox side, which is a card that is, you know, waning in popularity in the Secret Paladin deck. It's been cut down from the original almost certain 2 down to 1 or maybe even 0 occasionally. But just having that Consecration in hand is going to be helpful at some point in this game, since due to his slow start, he does find himself significantly behind on this board.
Yeah, the evolution of Secret Paladin has been pretty interesting. A lot of the early versions had, you know, 2 Consecrations, 2 True Silver Champions. Those were sort of these cards that were assumed to basically be in every Paladin deck. And now you see many versions that don't even have True Silver Champion, don't even have Consecration, because they're looking to play cards like Coghammer that allow them to even further leverage this board advantage they're able to generate early in the game.
Yeah, you can look at this deck and look at particular Paladin cards. You know, Coghammer is almost certainly a better card than True Silver Champion if you can guarantee always having a minion on board. Blessing of Kings is an incredibly powerful card if you can always guarantee having a minion on board. And if there's any deck in Hearthstone that's kind of close to that, as just being able to guarantee having something in play all the time, it's Secret Paladin, and that's why they've ended up moving towards these more kind of situational board-based cards.
Yeah. We do see the Blessing of Kings does come out in the token that was left, and he did get quite a reasonable trade, actually. Taking off that full health second imp gang boss is pretty important. And with the 5-3 now, it's still a bit of an awkward health for the Warlock to deal with. So just looking at the board in a vacuum, he would have to trade both minions in, which means there's only one more token from the imp gang boss. But obviously we can see there's maybe another option in the form of the Direwolf, or if he wants to go crazy, a Power Overwhelming.
The Direwolf would allow him to just trade in just the Imp Gang boss and also develop Haunted Creeper. Yep. That ends up matching up kind of poorly against the Consecration that we know is in Pokervox's hand, but it's sometimes these sort of decisions of having cards like Consecration in your deck, well, if people don't expect Consecration, they're less likely to play around Consecration because it's less popular and things like that. So there's a lot of sort of levels of thinking in this kind of spot.
Right, and I think if Bunnyhopper is looking at his hand and looking at the way turns develop, even if he does make the Direwolf play and ends up getting Consecrated, he'll be kind of okay with that because he gets to redevelop the next turn afterwards, have a solid minion in play with Lothar. But he is going to go with the Direwolf play, does play the Hornet Creeper, so Consecration will probably end up coming down here. But again, that does just pass the initiative back to Bunnyhopper.
Yeah, and the thing is as well, like if you always play around something like Consecrate, then like you're never really going to push for anything else, right? You know, like if he didn't have Consecrate this turn, then you're in an amazing spot. Right. So like the play was so good, and as you rightly said, like he's got the follow up of Lothar next turn, or maybe even you know the 2-1-1, the one drop minions and tap.
Well, the fact that Pokervox is actually on 5 mana this turn is a big deal in terms of even the threat of how good Consecration can be. Because if at most your opponent plays Consecration and a secret, that's not that big a deal. Yeah. It's not like your opponent is also developing something that will allow him to significantly threaten the board. And it looks like Pokervox doesn't even want to play the Consecration. He recognizes that it's more important that he is able to develop to the board himself than just play reactively here.
Especially pre-Challenger turn, right? Because Challenger on its own is actually, it's still strong to get all those secrets on, but it becomes so much better when you have at least just one other minion. But if you have two Divine Shielded minions, and this also, if the trades happen, the Avenge goes onto a Divine Shielded minion, which is huge. And then he's got two powerful minions on board next turn, unless, you know, Bunnyhopper's going to have to invest so much into clearing this board after the Avenge.
Right, and this play here from Pokervox has made this turn for Bunnyhopper maybe just a little bit more awkward than it would have been the other way, because he doesn't really want to play Lothar here because it doesn't really address the situation on the board, and you'd be playing Lothar into a turn where ideally your opponent doesn't want to play any spells.
Exactly.
They just want to jam their Mysterious Challenger. So he's created this situation now where Bunnyhopper has started his turn with the Life Tap, and now with just these 3-1 drops in hand, it's not the most powerful turn that Bunnyhopper will have ever seen as a Zoo player.
And what worked out actually really nice for Pokervox is that Avenge was the secret he played, because if he Mysterious Challenger, now there's two Avengers in the deck, right?
Yep.
So then the Mysterious Challenger gets full value and pulls the second event straight out along with it, because it was almost certain that the trade was going to happen this turn.
Yeah, so that combination of 3-1 drops is going to come out here. He gets the bad news that the Avenger is going to hit down on the mini-bot, but now that Consecration that was saved on the previous turn represents a ton of value, so Pokervox getting paid out in spades here for his recognition of the situation that playing Consecrate there was just handing initiative back to his opponent.
Yeah, I love this line of play from Pokervox here. It's fantastic. He recognized, as we were saying earlier, that the key is not just reacting and removing your opponent's board. The key is using that Consecration in a situation where it cements your advantage, and he was able to develop a very strong board with those two mini bots in the Avenge, and now he's just in a great spot.
Yeah, I mean, look at that turn from Bunnyhopper. It's not really what you want to do with 6 mana from the Zoo player. And the good thing now is, even though he delayed his Mysterious Challenger, which to like on a glance never looks great to like not play Mysterious Challenger on 6. Well, he didn't have a 7 drop, but he does have Tyrion, so now he can just go Mysterious Challenger straight into Tyrion and just say you're gonna have to have some crazy answers to close this game out for the Warlock.
I mean, Bunnyhopper has the potential for boom here, but if he attacks with either his minions, either of Pokervox's minions that gets avenged, or rather, if he attacks with the defender, either of the minions that gets avenged will be able to kill it. If he doesn't attack, the competitive spirit will allow him to kill Dr. Boom, and he gets to play the Tyrion next turn. So this is just a huge, huge advantage for PokerVac here.
Yeah, I mean, you just discussed at length a very, very unfavorable position there for Bunny Hopper, but then Tyrion the cherry on top as well just comes down and slams him out of this game. And on top of that, he's just not that far off from going face and winning the game either.
I think he's actually just looking at the odds on the 50-50 Coghammer to just straight up kill Dr. Boom and then just carry on. Because it puts up a massive taunt wall as well, which the Warlock normally has struggled dealing with. There's either Owl or then multiple trade-up minions, or the Boombots have to do some crazy work. So I wouldn't even mind Coghammer and Shredder here, because Tyrion, like I said, one of the best class legendaries, but he doesn't need it at the moment. He can do maybe more proactive things.
Right, interesting decision here from PokerVac, and he's shown already an ability to take the line that isn't immediately obvious, so he's going to consider all his options here, and it looks like he is just going to go ahead and make the clean trade, which suggests to me we're seeing a Tyrion Ford ring this turn.
Yeah, he would have played the Coghammer first if he was going to go for that route. I was kind of interested there, if he went for the Coghammer, is he just doing some form of like long-term BM where it's like, no, I'm going to play Paladin off-curve and still win?
Well, here, I mean, he's playing the Tyrion, not only just with Tyrion, but with Redemption up.
Yeah.
So his opponent has to get through.
He's hoping for these Boombots to kill
Redemption.
The mini
bot. Right. Noble Sacrifice is also still in play, though, which means the Redemption is most commonly going to trigger on that.
Yeah,
but
I
Tyrion does get avenged here, which helps out.
Yeah. Still, that's a gigantic, gigantic Tyrion. And he's big enough already.
Yeah.
So yeah, the Noble Sacrifice does end up getting redeemed. But you know, here, Bunny Hopper, what does he really have that can get him out of this? He has two Power Overwhelmings but can barely get through Tyrion.
The problem as well is he pretty much has to clear the board now, because if he just kills Tyrion, then there's lethal on board anyway, right? With the weapon. So he just has to clear the board or he loses, and that's just the way he is. So probably going to see the double PO and just hope.
This is interesting, because will he get the information of what the Boombot does? Yes, he will. He'll have 9 health into 9 attack. Yeah, okay, this is fine. Oh, interesting.
Oh, wow.
So he went for a line there to try and get lucky off the Boombot there, which I can't really blame him for. He has to find some luck to dig himself out of this bad situation. It's one of the situations where you really want to do play for some creative outs.
Yeah.
So.
This is looking pretty grim, especially when he can attack and then Coghammer if he wants to be like super safe. Not that he's in any real trouble, but he can just drop both Shredders and just not really care, to be honest, at this point.
That is the definition of asserting dominance. I don't need this Ashbringer. I'm just going to overwrite it right now with a Coghammer.
Yeah, he even knows that Bunny Hopper's already played two Power Overwhelming.
Yeah,
how much damage can possibly come out of that Warlock deck? The answer, I think, is going to be zero, as I would expect Bunny Hopper to possibly just concede on the spot.
Yep.
Bran Bronzebeard not quite going to get the job done. And despite all of us here on the desk favoring the zoo, the Secret Paladin does come out on top. So just shows what the hell do we know about Hearthstone, right, guys?
Why are we here?
Yeah.
I mean, one of the interesting things there was that PokerVac actually had a very poor opening.
Right.
He hero powered on turn two. And then he was just able to leverage the power of that double minibot avenge turn in the middle of the game to really turn everything around.
I think that was actually just the key turn, because when you see a Warlock actually lose this matchup when he went coin, Imgangboss, it's like so crazy. And we did see the Blessing of Kings clear up the bigger one. But like you said, the double minibot avenge was huge.
Yeah. I'm curious how things might have played out if Bunny Hopper had not chosen to actually kill a minibot that turn. Because I was thinking he could sort of test the secret, see if it's double sacrifice, and then if it's avenge, well, if it's avenge, that's terrible for you. So I wonder if at that point when you find out it's not avenge, maybe it would have worked out better if he just attacked the face.
Right. And remember, you guys at home can have your say on any of these games, anything that you've seen so far, any predictions going forward by using the hashtag HCT on Twitter or getting engaged on Facebook as well. But while we have a moment, let's just see what these two players had to say about the prospect of facing each other.
I am PokerVac, and I will prove you I am the best in the world.
If I want to try to do well, then I think I shouldn't think too much about who I'm facing right now or how much experience they have more than me.
My first opponent is Bunny Hopper, and we were doing a big research on him. He is a really good player, I think, but maybe not that experienced. The experience is really important, because when you're playing on a big event like this, you can be kind of nervous, do some mistakes.
Events like these, matches or exams, I always get nervous beforehand, and I usually don't sleep so well. But on the day, you're just so much into the game that I think I'll be fine.
I feel really confident because I already seen Bunny Hopper playing.
I think it's better to take every game step by step other than saying win it or bust.
Interesting stuff from the video there. Pokrovac saying that his maybe increased experience in card game tournaments, as you mentioned, Brian, might be important. And Bunny Hopper maybe backing that up, saying that he does have a little bit of a propensity for nerves here and there.
It's really strange when the 16-year-old is the grizzled veteran right. in the matchup. But yeah. I mean, it's the reality here. And though I do have to say that despite the fact that I have been playing games competitively for 20 years now, I still have trouble sleeping before tournaments. So.
Yeah, fair enough. Nerves affect people in a bunch of different ways, but the important thing there, I guess, for Bunny Hopper is that he said once he got into his zone, he was comfortable and he felt like he was playing good. So, you know, your preparation for tournament varies wildly. Like, do you guys have any particular rituals that you like to go through beforehand?
Well, I actually have a habit of picking a song for every tournament that I play in,
oh, nice.
And I listen to that song to sort of get me in the zone right. before every different round. It also allows me to have like these associations of particular songs with events. It's like, oh, I won this event. I really like this song.
Can you share any particular songs with great memories for you, Brian?
Well, Concrete Angel by Gareth Emery okay. and Out of the Sky by Lange were two songs from two of the biggest events I've ever won.
Raven, do you have any songs attached to your tournament? Oh, wait, you've never won any tournaments.
Oh,
right.
oh.
Anyway, moving
That's
forward,
a
before
lie.
Raven gets a
That's
chance
a
to respond.
Lie. Brutal.
What tournaments have you won, Sol?
And moving forward
what?
Again.
No, let's answer the question. What tournaments have you won?
You really want to ruin the broadcast by talking
oh,
about this?
That's convenient.
We have okay. from now until the end of the broadcast where I can list all of my tournament victories, but I'm not sure
oh,
whether people
okay.
will be too interested
okay.
in hearing
Just want to take
them.
Your... You gotta spread it out. You're going to need all that time, right?
Right, exactly. I'll drop one exactly. in here and there every now and again. But moving back, we have Druid from Bunny Hopper here up against what appears to be Patron Warrior from Pokrovac. This is a matchup we discussed pretty extensively in the previous series. But do you guys have any opinions on the favorability of this matchup?
Yeah, I just normally feel like if the warrior can do the patron thing on turn five, then it's like super favored. But if they like sort of struggle and maybe without a frothing berserker as well on curve, is normally pretty good against druid. But if they struggle to pull off that combo early enough, the druid can just be so far ahead that you know they can just threaten lethal, and it's very hard for the warrior to answer that.
Yeah, this is a very tempo based matchup. It's difficult for either player to get back in the game if they're significantly far behind. Druid can sometimes have the crazy like Azure Drake into, you know, Innervate or Wrath, Living Roots, kill all your patrons,
yeah, yeah.
but it mostly comes down to the player who gets a significant advantage early on.
Yeah, and that Deathbite draw is actually massive.
Yeah.
You just need Deathbite against Druid full stop, but also it's a key card in the Patron combo. For
yeah, this is a similar situation to what we saw in the previous series where the Patron Warrior was able to tempo out early with a couple of minions. In the previous case, it was two Armorsmiths, but similar start here. And then the Patron Deathbite draw was just right on time and it was just able to snowball. So.
Yeah, and there is going to be a Keeper of the Grove go down with the Silence, which is pretty key. This is definitely, when you're playing against Patron, you definitely don't want them to draw too many cards because that's how they win. It's essentially, it is like mid-range, I guess, but also very heavily reliant on combos.
I think the importance of Acolyte is less so in the sort of modern iterations of Patron yeah. since the Warsong Commander combo turns are no longer a big part of it. I actually think the recent iterations since the change to Warsong Commander are stronger against it, kind of for that reason. They're more focused on playing just this mid-range game, and they can get ahead better than the versions that had so many of these combo pieces, which is what's key in this matchup.
Yeah, I completely agree with you. Additions like Piloted Shredder, Dread Corsair, which was phased out of Warsong Patron by the end as well, and even things like Dr. Boom and Grommash, like these are things that you want to have
right.
against Druid because
yeah.
you want to fight on the board where, like, more honestly than just sit back and try and well, you know, wait 12 turns and then combo them. Like, Druid is going to kill you
yeah,
most of the time.
If you don't threaten anything, it becomes a huge problem. Whereas that one of the huge weaknesses of Druid is dealing with multiple minions on the board at the same time, because they don't normally have an effective way to do that.
Time waits for no one.
And Bunny Hopper here, kind of debating what he wants to do. It looks like it's just going to be this Piloted Shredder. Interesting
yeah.
to see the Shredder rather than perhaps the Druid of the Claw.
Right.
I think he just wants something to have the highest chance of something staying on board next turn, right?
Yeah.
Because the Druid of the Claw just dies to the weapon and, say, the Acolyte.
Yeah, that's true. And
yeah.
Interestingly, it looks like Pokervac's going to go with the Frothing Berserker and slam. Is this axe just gonna go to the face, or is he just gonna kill it? I imagine he's probably gonna hold on to this death spike at this stage.
Yeah, I think he's gonna hold on to it. Just use the unstable ghoul to trade here. Hope that there is no Doomsayer Nightmare. Argent Watchman is a big old pile of stats, but you know he'll if the Druid player wants to use that, he is going to have to commit 2 mana to Hero Power, which based on this hand right now is a pretty clunky, awkward thing for him to be doing in the long term.
Yeah, Bunnyhopper could do something like play the Keeper of the Grove and damage the Berserker here, then Hero Power and trade there.
Right.
That ends up not really advancing his board very much, but it does give him the ability to deal with this Berserker, which is pretty key.
And this is one of the things with the Berserker, and by not attacking with the weapon, which seems, you know, it's a fairly common thing. Play Berserker, attack, Whirlwind, mm-hmm. buff it. But this also leaves the Berserker on 4, which means it either needs a Wrath and a Hero Power, or because the minion can't really attack unless you do Hero Power, so it soaks that up. Or you just need a Swipe, which on this board isn't fantastic either. Or you can just play Dr. Boom, which is pretty reasonable.
That can lead to a really big Berserker.
Yeah. Not if the Boombots kill it first.
It's true. Boombots can have a pretty big impact on exactly what happens here. And so can Grim Patron.
Yeah. And he has the Execute as well, so he has the 1 mana spare to prop the Execute on the Dr. Boom, so he doesn't even need to attack. He's going to kill the 2-4 and clear that straight up off the board.
There's always a decision here as well. It's like, how greedy am I? Like, I could just bank this 5 damage now in case the Boombots end up killing it, but he's going to take the risk. Frothing Berserker is still green, which means it has lived.
It is alive.
So the important thing here is whether these Boombots interact with the patrons and how.
That is pretty huge.
Oh,
you get
wow.
an additional patron, an additional point of power on
and
that Frothing
casual
Berserker.
Casual 13 attack.
Just 13. Lucky 13 damage right there. Wow. That
yeah,
was huge.
So Bunnyhopper went for the Gusto on the previous turn. He said, you know what, Dr. Boom's a good card. I have access to 7 mana this turn, but it ends up biting him. Pokrovac with the huge swing turn, taking the risk against the Boombots, getting paid out for it. He goes up on a 2-0 lead, looking very, very impressive so far, guys.
Yeah, that last turn, the Dr. Boom into the Frothing Berserker, that seemed pretty dangerous to me. Just having that many minions in play, leaving your opponent with that Frothing Berserker, it seemed like perhaps an unnecessary risk from Bunnyhopper there.
I think if there wasn't a second charge Death Bite on the board, mm-hmm. then yeah, you can be a bit risky. But with it, you're putting more minions on the board. Like, do you really just want to put the all in the chance of it not killing off the Frothing Berserker and just hope for the best? Like, it was pretty huge, but I think it was a little bit risky when he could have just safely cleared it and then moved on for the next turn.
Right. I think it's, like, to be fair, we have to point out that what Pokrovac had in his hand was, like, the perfect answer
turn. Of course.
Like, Patron, Execute, and the Death Spite that we already knew about. But, you know, you guys are right. Like, reasonable expectations. You can expect something bad to happen to you that turn. But anyway, let's take a moment right now to find out a thing or two extra about Pokrovac.
I'm Pokrovac, I'm 16 years old, and I'm from Czech Republic. Living in Prague is pretty fun. I want to live there in my whole life. I started playing card games when I was 6. My father just put some cards together and we were playing. I started playing tournaments competitively at something like 9 years old. I were on 3 Grand Prix. 2 were in Prague and 1 were in Bochum. And I did some money finishes on them. And then I also started playing table tennis, and it was fun. I started playing Hearthstone when some guys from that another card game told me it existed. And after I started playing, I hit Legion in 1.5 weeks. Definitely my past experience with other card games helped me a lot in Hearthstone. So I'm on high school right now. The people from my school, they are like, oh, it's a Pokrovac. They stop me sometimes and just take a signature from me or something like this. It's really cool. My father was really important for me because he was every time a biggest support for me. I was nervous on competitions, but he taught me how to focus on the games, do not pay attention for other things, and he was like, you can do it, you can win it. But my mother is more like, I have to study more, play less of my games. If I win this weekend, my mother will definitely be more supportive, I think. My chances for winning this event are big, I'm really confident. My practice partner for this event was Stan Sivka, and we were training a lot like 4 or 5 hours every day, and then a whole weekend. I want to prove I'm the best in the world, and I just want to win the world championship, maybe to be idol for some new players. So representing the Czech Republic doesn't mean much for me because I just do not care much about these things. I'm just playing for myself and I want to win it, not for Czech Republic, but for me and for my parents or my supporters. I'm Pokrovac and I will prove you I'm the best in the world.
Pokrovac ready to prove that he is the best in the world. We've seen a few players making these kinds of statements throughout this entire Hearthstone Championship Tour process. Most of them have been burned by it. The one guy that's got to back that up so far is Amnesiac. Guys, do you think Pokrovac might be able to follow in his footsteps?
I think it's very possible, yeah. I mean, just from seeing that video, he just oozes like focus, right? He just knows exactly what he needs to do. He's been brought up to play card games and win at them, as we saw. So, like, he's just, everything's going his way. And from what we've seen so far, extremely solid play. So I have no doubts he could take it all the way.
Literally bred from childhood to be right here, right now.
he's progressed so far so quickly as well. 16 years old already, a local celebrity, being asked for autographs at
school.
That
was not my high school experience, I'll tell you that.
Well, Pokrovac apparently has it solved. He knows the way to navigate through. Apparently, if you're good at card games, then coasting through school is a breeze.
Ooh, this is what we're here for. The priest deck.
Yes.
So, and as far as opening hands go, getting both Zombie Chow and Nausea Cleric as options in your opening hand is pretty solid. But in general, guys, how do we feel about the Druid matchup? Because this is definitely something with a bit of controversy. People tend to have differing opinions on this matchup.
Yeah, I think there's just some super reliant cards for the Priest more than anything. I think you just need, whether the Light Bombs or the Alcanai Circles, just keep the board clear and get rid of those shades is important because, although the Priest is like a healing class and can heal, they can't normally heal that fast without, say, Flash Heal or anything like that. So they can get put into lethal range very easily from the Druid, and the big minions are normally difficult to deal with.
Yeah. My experience playing Priest, and Priest is actually the class that I probably played the most or second most with Mage. Never Freeze Mage, though. But
I just want to put that out there.
I got to clear that up first. But no, my experience, the Priest actually does best against Druid when it plays a tempo game itself. Yep. Cards like Injured Blade Master, cards like Deathlord, in particular in combination with Valence Chosen, allow it to establish a big minion and then heal it, which makes it incredibly difficult for a Druid to keep up.
Yep. I love that sensor that went off in Kibler's head there. It was just like, hang on, people might think I play Freeze Mage. I have to correct this right now.
Freeze Mage has a dragon in it.
I have a reputation to uphold.
Anyway, Zombie Chow coming down here, turn one from Pokrovac, and Bunny Hopper with the Wild Growth and Shredder in his hand, alongside a couple of flexible cards like the Living Roots and the Wrath, is probably feeling pretty comfortable about his situation right now, but there is the opportunity for this hand from Pokrovac to explode very quickly if something like a Wild Pyromancer is picked up. Then that Circle of Healing can start to draw him every single card he needs in his deck.
Yeah, and that counteracts one of the issues this type of Priest can have sometimes. There's a lot of different cool combos you can do with Priest, but there's a lot of times you're like, I have Circle, no Alcanai, or any heal capabilities with the Cleric, and then you know you just have like a Shrinkmeister, but nothing, you know, no Cabal late game and things like that. So drawing is going to be really important here to just fill his hand and just have all those options available to him as quick as possible.
See, I don't like this play from Pokrovac here. I think he needed to threaten his opponent and heal his opponent's face before attacking on turn two. It's really a crucial element of the Priest repertoire. You got to get that in there.
Yeah, that is only stuff that advanced Priest players like Ryan Kibler here are capable of realizing. But
told you, I played a lot.
Right, yeah. I mean, it's the next level plays. And here we see this is the combination deck where that has both Flash Heal and Light of the Naru in it. This is something that came to popularity fairly recently. Previously, it was just Light of the Naru that was being used as the burst healing in the deck because it can also give you that board presence. But then people started to realize that the Flash Heal tempo with Orcanai was really beneficial a lot of the time, and also just the extra burst healing served a good job as well.
Yeah, the difference between 3 and 5 with Akanai is huge. It's the difference between being able to kill something like an Azure Drake or Ancient of Lore and, well, not. Very often the Light Warden you get from Light of the Naru isn't a huge threat. It can very easily die, but the ability to have those big board swings thanks to the Flash Heal, as well as to heal that additional burst for certain matchups as well.
Yeah, well, the thing as well, it being only one mana, you can like just play that almost any turn once you hit like mid to late game. You can just squeeze it in wherever you want.
Right, that's the point as well, because you know Brian made the direct example of, you know, being able to kill an Ancient of Law or not, but also the difference between 3 and 5 is also just 2 mana. Like, that's an extra hero power. With Orcanai, to do that 2 extra damage, you'll need to invest 2 more mana. To get that 2 extra points of healing, you will need to heal your face with the 2 extra mana.
Yeah, one of the most difficult matchups for many Priest decks has historically been Freeze Mage. One of the reasons I'm not really a big Freeze Mage fan, because I like to play a lot of Priest. But having cheap, big heals like Flash Heal, like Light of the Nauru, can actually allow you to, you know, beat the Alexstrasza turn, which is what's right. The most important thing in that particular matchup.
Especially when you look at if, like, True Hearts come down as well, that your hero power is healing for 4 or dealing damage for 4 with the Alcanai. But this is looking pretty strong from Bunny Hopper so far. The Shred is down, the Druid of the Claw goes down. He clears up that Chao because we are edging towards the turns where Alcanai can come down and then suddenly trading and doing 5 damage to your face kind of sucks.
Right, and without that Sludge Belcher draw here from Pokervac, his hand is kind of looking like that kind of thing that you described, Raven, where it's just individual parts of combos, situational cards, things that are too expensive to cast. You know, this is one of the criticisms of Priest since pretty much the beginning, that they're forced to play this reactive game, and if you don't have the right reactive cards at the right time, you can just fall too far behind. But can he afford to wait here? Is there another play apart from the Sludge Belcher? If he plays the Sludge Belcher, what does he do next turn, Raven? These are all questions. Yeah. Do you have answers for us?
Maybe I don't have all of the answers here, but I think it's very difficult. If he doesn't Sludge Belcher, then the rest, anything else he does is just bad, right? So like Sludge Belcher, maybe not something he wanted to do this turn overall in his like game plan for the match, but it's just the best outcome here. And the only positive thing is Bunny Hopper's hand seems very weird as well. There's nothing too crazy going on until he's just drawn Ancient of Law. So he has this turn to just use the Wrath if he wants, maybe just put the Living Roots down. Like you are going straight into the Holy Nova turn, so maybe you just want to use it for the damage to help clear the Sludge Belcher.
One thing that's worth noting is that this particular turn and the use of the coin by Pokervac, the coin is particularly valuable in Priest decks because of things like the Wild Pyromancer plus draw 1 million cards with Circle of Healing.
Right.
You get a lot of additional value out of that coin. I think I actually remember seeing some statistics of Priest win rates in certain matchups when you have the coin in the in a Wild Pyromancer deck. It's vastly more successful.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense, but he does commit the coin, which again also just leaves him ready without a play next turn. He can't play either of those 6 drops now, the Light Bomb or the Cabal, because he's already committed his coin. And it feels like he's about to just continue to fall further behind on this board. Brian, how do you feel about him using the Wrath to cycle there? Because he had the option to clear the Sludge Belcher cleanly, losing the Wrath and Living Roots and just pushing his minions through.
I think I like it there. The Living Roots isn't particularly valuable to as a damage source there. You kind of want to use the Wrath to cycle in this matchup as well. The 3 damage mode isn't particularly valuable, whereas you can dig to things like Dr. Boom with the card draw effect.
Yeah, I really like the Living Roots here as well, is because it sort of gives a nod to the Priest, like, oh, this sort of looks okay to Holy Wrath. You don't normally Living Roots into turn 5, but I have a Druid of the Claw on 5 health. Like, Holy Nova is your whole turn, so, you know, leaving that alive is fine. So he does end up just playing the Chao, and this is what I mean. There's just so many issues now, like, the Light of the Nauru just doesn't really do anything. The Flash Shield can't do anything at the moment. Second he draws an Alcanai, he's in business, though.
Right, and just like if you're sitting from Bunny Hopper's side of the table right now, just reacting to Pokervac's last few turns, we've seen a couple of very passive turns. We've seen a coin Sludge Belcher on the previous turn, and we've seen this turn essentially 5 mana being floated. It was a 1 drop and healing. What kind of reads does that give you about your opponent's hand?
Well, you're going into turn 6, which is the Light Bomb turn, is the really important thing there. So Bunny Hopper doesn't want to commit Dr. Boom despite being the larger threat. And here he plays the Ancient. Even if it dies, it's already drawn him a couple cards. I wouldn't be surprised to see these 1-1s, yeah, just go in and take out this this Zombie Chow to protect his 4-5, which is the 5 being the key. It's a bigger number than the other one from the Light Bomb.
This is really, really nice play, because it just makes like, well, Light Bomb, yeah, it makes it 4-1, and that kills off the 5-5 off the board, but is that enough for a Light Bomb? It needs to be much greater from that, I think.
Yeah, I don't think that Pogorak can realistically commit Light Bomb here, because he knows as soon as he does it, the Druid will more than likely, based on the size of their hand, just be able to re-slam a bunch more aggressive minions. So the proactive play to try and fight his way back onto the board here with the Nausea Cleric and the Injured Blade Master, which Kibler pointed out at the start of the game, is a very, very important minion. Perhaps coming down a little bit too late here for Pokrovac's liking, but still able to cycle through his deck quite effectively with that Norsha Cleric.
And what's happened now is, like, this, although, you know, it's not a terrible turn in any way, shape, or form. You know, he drew a lot of cards and was got a pretty good board now, but having to use the circle, then drawing into both Alcanize yeah, is right. Just... this is what it feels like for Priest to go wrong to a certain extent. I'm not saying Prokrovac's game is over in any way, but, you know, this is just when it feels bad, where you're forced to use these combo pieces in a way you don't really want to, and then draw into the cards you did want.
Speaking of combo pieces, Bunnyhopper has all of them in his hand. He has, you know, Force of Nature plus Savage Roar. So if he is able to deal with Prokrovac's board here and get him low in life, he can very easily present lethal early as next turn.
Yeah, all two pieces of that incredibly complex druid combo are in Bunnyhopper's hand right now. So yeah, I'm sure that is the consideration that he's following right now, is what is the right balance between addressing this board and potentially setting up lethal for myself on the following turn.
This is nice. I was weighing up whether he was going to just keep of the Grove, Wrath onto the 1-3, push face. And then just say, well, yeah, you've got a Blade Master, but what's that single Blade Master going to do against this whole board? And then, you know, then he can threaten lethal with combo next turn.
Really interesting stuff there. He chose to sacrifice 1 health and 4 damage to face by trading his Druid of the Claw instead of just wrathing down the Norsha Cleric.
Or just leaving it there.
Right, sure.
Yeah. That's kind of interesting. And here we see the power of that Flash Heal. 5 damage, exactly enough to kill the Druid of the Claw. And if he had not attacked into that Norsha Cleric, if he had, for instance, played the Wrath, that wouldn't have been possible.
Yeah, and even if you left it up, well, the Cleric could have gone in, but he gains 4 damage.
Right.
And so, you know, I felt a bit too defensive there. I think he could have gone a lot more aggressive.
Yeah, I was a little surprised by how, given the state of the game and given Bunnyhopper's hand, just how powerful it is with the Force Roar, that he's sort of letting this game go on. And as he lets the game go on, that allows the Priest to draw into its sort of combo pieces and kind of get back into this.
Yeah, especially after you've seen on the previous turn your opponent cycle a bunch of cards with the Norsha Cleric Injured Blade Master turn, you'd start to expect that, like, okay, this guy had a really passive start, he whiffed on a bunch of stuff, but now those important draws are going to be starting to come into his hand.
And we see this Dr. Boom as well in hand, it's still not getting played. I think one of the issues is still no Light Bomb, still no Entomb. You know, there are a lot of cards that can really punish him, or even a Shadow of Death if there's one in the deck. Right. There's still so many cards that can punish Dr. Boom. And if it's something like Entomb, again, like you said, because the game's going longer and longer, it's going to work out a lot better for the Priest, because he's not even particularly under that much pressure, sitting on 25 health at the moment.
It's interesting, the Acolyte Paint in Pokerbox hand. We see a lot of variation in the creatures, the minions that that Priest X play. Deathlord has been a super popular one against a lot of the aggressive decks. Acolyte of Pain allows a lot more sort of cycle through your deck, especially with Valen's Chosen, with Wild Pyromancer. And I'm curious to see what sort of just overall build he has here. You know, there's a lot of sort of core cards, but there's so many little individual pieces you can rotate through the Priest deck that really change the way it functions in certain matchups.
Yeah, there certainly is. Lots of little individual twists. You know, whether or not you play Justicar, even Elise is a consideration. And then there's some potential combo finishes that sometimes you see in Priest decks as well. So all of these are indicative of various things, and interesting to see what the additional cycle of the Acolyte of Pain indicates.
Yeah, I generally find that Acolyte of Pain usually lines up with Elise these days, because Elise is a card that allows you to turn all your sort of low-impact situational cards into big threats in control matchups. One of the things that sometimes control Priest decks can suffer from in matchups against other control decks is you have cards like Light of Thanaru, like Circle of Healing, that when they're not serving as these sort of combo removal effects, don't really do very much. But if you can turn those into Dr. Booms and anything but a Nat Pagel, you know, you're in pretty good shape.
Yeah, but looking at the state of the game now, Pokrovac has managed to fight his way back onto the board, having had to react to a very aggressive start from Bunnyhopper with not many options of his own. But now we've reached the situation where, because both Ancient of Laws were drawn from the Druid, it's just in the position where Bunnyhopper just is out resourcing the Priest and is able going to just be able to put gas on the board every single turn and just demand answers from the Priest repeatedly.
Yeah, and what's interesting as well is how long Pokrovac actually holds on to Light Bomb. Because the idea is, if you just wait and wait, and wait, and Bunny Hopper's playing minions like Shredder, Ancient of Lore, and just never plays Dr. Boom because he won't need it, then the Light Bomb never gets played, and then you just fall behind in that sense as well.
Yeah, there is a game of chicken going on here of, you know, Bunny Hopper not wanting to commit that Dr. Boom until the Light Bomb is out, and Pokravac waiting for like a more explosive Light Bomb than the ones he's being presented with. But it's a game where if it keeps developing, it's a game of chicken that the Druid player is going to win because the Priest is the one that's on the clock here.
Exactly, yeah.
The problem is that it's the Force of Nature Savage Roar right here that we see in Bunny Hopper's hand that I think what we're going to see is this, this, and then heal the Keeper here, and then the Light Bomb, because he's going to hope that the Keeper can kill what comes out of the Shredder to keep that Force Roar.
Well, also, could Alcanine use the Light of the Naru to kill whatever comes out of the Shredder next turn, worst case scenario.
All right, well, that's a 2-3, so that was not what he was hoping to see. He was hoping to see some sort of 2 or less power minion. So that actually is 1 damage off lethal now with Force Roar for Bunny Hopper here. He's able to have the 14 from the combo itself, and then 4 more from the 2 power minion in play. Very close.
Yeah, this is going to be so interesting for Bunny Hopper because he has a lot of good cards. Like, for example, even just Drake's Shade feels pretty good because he has the combo next turn. But that plays very heavily into a Light Bomb. So it's going to be really difficult, like you said, Sol. It's like a game of chicken. And it's whether whoever overcommits first might be in a bit of a problem.
Right, well, having just seen the Light Bomb used, he might be in a reasonable position to just overcommit like that. And it is the only AoE he's seen so far, so even concerns like Holy Nova might be in the back of his head
Exactly.
with the Shade of Naxxramas. And so there is additional AoE that he does have to consider here, but maybe now that one Light Bomb, which I'm pretty sure he had a nice read was in the hand, is gone, we're going to see the commitment of the Dr. Boom here.
Yeah, Dr. Boom here after the Light Bomb is a huge threat because even if he can deal with the Dr. Boom itself, those Boom Bots represent a huge amount of damage thanks to Savage Roar.
Right, like you can either leave them on the board and then they're going to do compounded damage with the combo, or you can deal with them, in which case there's a decent chance they just hit you in the face and put you into vanilla combo range anyway.
Yeah, and I like holding onto the Shade from Bunny Hopper as well, because it does play around the Holy Nova or, you know, any other forms of AoE, and just holds onto that minion one more so he can play it the following turn if there's anything too crazy that comes out.
This power match is kind of an interesting draw from Pokravac here. It is potentially dangerous in that he can, he can clear the board here. He could play the Soul Priest and then Flash Heal the Boom. He's a little bit short. He has to play the Pyromancer first. If the Pyromancer dies to a Boom Bot, it doesn't work.
Yeah.
But he could play Soul Priest, Pyromancer, and both of his spells, and he's guaranteed to clear the board. The problem being that the Pyromancer itself is quite vulnerable. He could attack into the Boom first. He attacks into the Boom first.
Yeah.
And then plays it. Oh, he's gonna ping. Okay. He's actually not gonna play around the. Oh no. Okay. This works too. There's any number of ways you can make this work with his hand here. But now he doesn't risk the Boombots actually killing his Pyromancer. Does kill it, but doesn't matter at this stage.
Yep. Sequenced correctly, and also gets away with the Boombots not doing enough damage to face there to make this combo lethal. So he does still have the 3-1 Arcanine in play right now.
But which is actually kind of an awkward situation, because the Arcanine being in play means that even his Light of the Naru in hand and his hero power can no longer heal him. Bunny Hopper could just Force Roar combo, put him to 4 life, and currently Pokravac would have to kill his own Arcanine and then heal himself back up.
Yeah, which with these two minions down isn't going to be good enough. That's the real problem. He just needs to draw into something, because as you said, right, he needs to hero power his own. Oh, he does trade with it. Okay.
All right. Well, it does prevent his opponent from being able to kill this Azure Drake as well. So
it's like a trade-off, right?
The Azure Drake remaining in play is more dangerous than keeping your opponent from being able to heal. If Pokravac had had, say, a Justicar in play, maybe it's different. If he had more burst healing, but he's already used so much of it too.
Yeah, you can see if the Arcanine was left alive there and he just went for some big burst turn, he does have the possibility, even with this small hand, he could have hero powered down his own Arcanine and then Light of the Naru'd himself in the face, so he was able to gain some sort of life. So I think in as comfortable a position as Bunny Hopper is, he just doesn't need to make that level of commitment to the board. So. And there we have it. Druid combo comes down. Force of Nature, Savage Roar, 14 points of damage from an empty board, but roughly a million damage from that board state. Bunny Hopper climbs his way back into the game, and I think the tournament graveyard, Kibler, is littered with people who have just brought that one wrong deck to a tournament, and it just hasn't worked out. Could that happen to Pokravac here with the Priest deck?
It's possible. I mean, he was saying in some of his discussions before that this was a deck that he had tested quite a bit with Stan Sifka, and Stan is someone who, you know, definitely does a lot of preparations for events. Pokrovac was saying he and Stan were testing for 4-5 hours a day. I doubt he's going to be bringing a deck that is weak to the entire field, let alone the Druid can be a tough matchup, especially with the kind of start that Pokrovac had there.
Yeah, exactly. I think with that matchup versus the Druid, it was always going to be probably the toughest one out of this with the Paladin and Warlock left as well. So I think Pokrovac, especially with his experience in tournament play, isn't going to be feeling too upset at this point. Just be like, right, okay, you know, I lost versus the Druid, but I've got two more pretty decent matchups.
Right. Bunnyhopper does still have a bit of an uphill struggle in front of him, but let's find out a little bit more about him and what it takes to potentially overcome this.
I'm Raphael. I'm 24. I'm currently living in Oslo, but I'm originally from Cologne, Germany. Yeah, I played competitive chess until I was 18. And so I started that when I was 7, and that was great fun. I used to play county regional championships every year, and that was basically a planned part of my Easter holidays. And it was always fun rather than just competition. I think the overlap between Hearthstone and chess is quite great because it really requires you to think about your opponent's possibilities. Then you also have to think a few turns ahead, and you also have to think tactically. And in chess, it's just the moves that now are a specific combination. In Hearthstone, it's, of course, which plays the best.
And that's going to do it. You guys have gone over it 1,000 times already. Bunnyhopper is moving on to the Europe Winter Championship. What a ride for him.
I got a master's degree in theoretical chemistry at the University of Oxford, and I'm working on my PhD in a 4-year program at the University of Oslo. Currently, I'm working on the investigation of organic chemistry with means of computer simulations, and also work on computer simulations of proteins that are involved in the visual cycle. Before the preliminaries, my schedule of the week used to be like, firstly, go to work 9 to 5. Tuesdays and Thursdays, play volleyball as well as go to a language class. Monday and Wednesday, play some Hearthstone tournaments to wrap some BlizzCon points, then just save the weekend for going out with friends. In order to be really, really good at the game, I would need to invest more time into the game than I currently have on my hands. I'm totally okay with having a set limitation, firstly from my skills and secondly from my time to the game, just by setting other priorities higher, but that's my decision and therefore I will live with the consequences and see how far I can make it at the level that I play right now. I'm Bunnyhopper, and I'm here to prove that I have what it takes to make it to BlizzCon.
PhD in theoretical chemistry. Now, I had no idea what he was talking about when he was talking about protein strains or whatever it was, but I think what we can take away from this, Bunnyhopper is a smart guy.
Yep.
I don't even know what theoretical chemistry means.
Right. Makes us on the desk maybe not quite look so clever, but still. But he's very, I kind of like Bunnyhopper because he's quite humble and honest about his opinion on his sort of place in Hearthstone at the moment as well. He just says, you know, I've got a lot of things to do, but I'll just see how far I can get.
Apparently, Bunnyhopper has not done enough to convince the people at home that he's a smart guy, though. Pokrovac still favored in the Twitter poll that you can vote in using the hashtag HCT, but no surprise since he does only have that priest deck left to pick up a win with. And if we can just take a look at the classes here.
Yeah, we have, yeah, I believe it is the Warlock and Paladin left for Bunnyhopper.
Right.
And as we were saying earlier, he prepared for both the preliminary and for this event to some degree with Diggin. Mm-hmm. And I believe that we saw Bunnyhopper playing that aggressive Paladin deck as well as an aggressive Warlock deck.
Yeah, Diggin was playing it, right?
Correct, yes. Which I think are typically pretty good matchups for right. Control Priest.
Yeah, I mean, Priest historically considered one of the best anti-aggro classes mm-hmm. in the game, you know, alongside Warrior, and perhaps even better than Warrior in a lot of situations because it's able to react to the board a lot better than Warrior can in some situations. That's just based on gaining life over and over again, and if the board presence gets out of control, then Warrior's life total doesn't matter. So might end up being paid out here. As you said, he's tested this Priest deck very, very extensively. Obviously feels it's powerful in these kinds of situations, and he does come up against the aggressive Zoo Warlock, and this opening hand,
this hand,
Brian, I can see your face right now. Real life Brian Kibler Craigasm is happening right now.
No, this hand is exactly what you want, and that's actually even better with the mulligan.
Yep.
The zombie chow in turn one, and then he has Wild Pyromancer and Powered Shield with the coin. There's basically no better opening hand you could ask for as a priest against an aggressive warlock.
Yeah, I think what's really crazy as well, you look at Bunnyhopper's opening hand on itself,
it
and you're like, this is insane, this is such a good opening, but you're like, but the priest opening still trumps it. So.
Yeah, and this is exactly why priest has such a strong matchup against aggressive decks. It has the ability to not only deal with the powerful openings from the aggressive decks, but to do so without really expending resources.
Right.
And it continues to threaten to continue to deal with them.
Wow, more early tempo cards picked up here. Light of the Naru can be an additional proc for that Wild Pyromancer if he needs it. So the explosiveness of his opening hand here is coming together so nicely against what, as you said, is just looked like a pretty great opening zoo hand from Bunnyhopper.
Yeah, I really like the way he played the Squire. A lot of people just want to snap the flame in because it's the highest damage minion. But what it is, Squire's got Divine Shield, and I have Abusive in hand for next turn, so I can trade up into a Cleric, a Zombie Chow, a Pyro, if it, you know, anything like that came out. So that was really nice play there.
Yeah, Bunnyhopper definitely looking at what's bad for me here, and the answer is Zombie Chow, and he had the perfect sequence that he could deal with it. But now this is also very bad for you. This is Pyromancer Coin Shield, which leaves Bunnyhopper with nothing.
Right, and as you guys said, great recognition of the matchup from Bunnyhopper to get that Argent Squire out and make the tempo play with the Abusive Sergeant that left him with something on board against a Zombie Chow or Nausea Cleric, but it all comes to nothing because, as we said, the power of this opening hand from Pokrovac is able to deal with even that initially disgusting-looking board state from the zoo.
Yeah, and look at this as well. Like, Dark Peddler, well, it will die next turn 100% because now the Pyromancer can be healed and trade if that's it. And, you know, like, so maybe Bunnyhopper might have to just play the egg and then hope he can go Dark Peddler into something like Power Overwhelming to deal with this minion.
Yeah, I mean, this is really where Priest shines because the Priest hero power and the Warrior hero power may seem very similar. It's like, oh, gain two life. It's like, well, this one actually allows you to continue to milk this board advantage. You've gotten ahead on board, and now anything that Bunnyhopper plays in this Pyromancer is just going to die, and it's just going to get healed.
Yeah. I think this is one. It's like Priest is like, once it gets you down, you stay down. That's one of the things. You don't get back up from Priest.
Yeah, I mean, the Priest hero power naturally just sort of snowballs an advantage. Once you gain an advantage as Priest against a lot of minion-based strategies, the hero power allows you to just lean on them until the game's over.
Yeah, the Priest hero power is so polarizing. When you're ahead on the board, it may just be the best hero power in the game. When you're behind on the board, it may end up being the worst.
Yeah, we saw in game one, when you're behind on the board, you don't even use it when you have the mana.
Right, just like, sure, hero power.
Go. That's why you need to get the threat and heal you in. If nothing else, it makes you feel better about yourself because you did something with your turn.
Right. Suddenly the play makes sense. I didn't understand the line the first time, Kibler, but now you explain it, that makes perfect sense.
It's key. It's
this
key,
is right. Not the peddler he was looking for.
I imagine that with like a Jedi wave.
Exactly.
Like,
that's what that was the effect I was going for, guys.
That was good. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that.
Yeah, and then he taps into the abusive, which even with the egg wouldn't have actually done too much. He couldn't kill any minion, and then it would have just been traded away the turn after. It's looking really rough for Bunnyhopper.
Yeah, this is not a great spot for him. Pokrovac has to be worried about something like a Power Overwhelming, cracking that egg, killing his Pyromancer here. He could just play the Acolyte, try and set that up to draw some cards. Also, it has to be on his mind is the possibility of something like Defender of Argus. So he's likely going to want to just kill these minions. So I don't dislike just kill your 2/2, attack your face, heal my guy, go, and just save the rest of this.
He could actually clear off the egg and the Nerubian afterwards as well to just remove that Power Overwhelming effect. Mm-hmm. But it would use like Powered Shield and Light of the Naru to get the effects off the board. But it would clear the whole board. So there is a chance in that. So.
Yeah, it looks like he might be going for something like that.
Yeah, I mean, he's going to Power Shield onto the Zombie Chow, which still allows it to trade for free into the 2/2 after the effect goes off. He draws an additional card straight away with the Acolyte of Pain, and Holy Champion is drawn.
I like that.
And Holy Champion is drawn. Yeah.
That's a card that I love, like, because one of the problems with Priest decks is, in fact, their inherently reactive nature, and it's very difficult for a lot of Priest decks to close out games quickly. And there are a lot of cards and strategies that kind of demand that. Things like Reno Warlock, cards like Jiraxxus, and Holy Champion allows you to have that kind of burst. And similarly, we see the double Light of the Naru, and I think we saw two Flash Heals last game. Yeah. So he has the full healing package that can be used to buff your Holy Champion quite quickly and make it huge, as well as burn spells with the Akanai Soul Priest. So he can kind of, you know, heal you or kill you, whichever you want.
It's kind of interesting as well, because the second I saw that card, up until that point, I was like, oh, Stansifka and Pokrovac are very confident about this priest deck they've been working on. It's really good. I was like, it's control priest, you know? sure. But then when you realize, oh, Holy Champion, Stansifka has looked at this deck, this makes sense. Because he's known for just putting his own sort of slant on maybe more standard decks.
Right. And I will say there was a stat that appeared on screen earlier that said Bunnyhopper is 69% against priests in ranked play with his Warlock. Now, while that may be true, and that is that's probably true for most people, that is because of control Warlock decks, not the zoo that he's playing right now. So, but yeah, that Holy Champion might start having an impact very soon, because one of the ways that Priest can potentially still lose this matchup after such a powerful start is they just run out of things to do.
Just run out of juice.
They get stuck back into that reactive sense, and then the zoo starts drawing two cards a turn and slowly overwhelms them. But now with the Orcanai and the Holy Champion in hand as well, he has the gas that he needs to even just keep up the pressure against the zoo player.
And the more I think about it, especially in this matchup, I really like the Holy Champion, because you don't even have to do anything crazy with it. If you put that on the board, your opponent has to deal with it, right? It has that kind of sort of half taunt effect where it's like, if you leave this alive, I could just kill you next turn. And then when the zoo's trading into minions like that and the priest is still on 30 health, you're feeling pretty good.
Yeah, when Holy Champion was first released, I played Holy Champion decks for like a week straight, because that's just the sort of card and the style of priest deck that I want to play.
I thought you were going to say, that's just the sort of person I am.
That's also true. I'm the sort of person who wants to kill my opponent in dramatic fashion.
Yeah.
So Lotheb coming down here, abusive Sergeant to create the favorable trade onto the Sludge Belcher, and the zoo is starting to get into a position now where they can build up some pressure. That Lotheb's going to protect from any potential removal options this turn, but the problem is the priest is still sitting pretty at 30, so the priest can still just clean up what he can here and then just react to the board on the following turn, no harm done.
Yeah, I actually feel like Pokrovac, if he really wanted, could just not do anything this turn. And then just light bomb next turn and be like, okay, keep going Warlock, keep tapping, because it's only going to help me as well. He does have Alcanai, and you know, he does have actually a decent amount of burst with the two Light of the Narrows if that's the route he wants to take. But this turn's really just like, he'll probably just kill off the 4-1 just to reduce the damage a little bit and then just answer whatever happens next turn with a pretty confident light bomb.
Ooh, looks like he may be going with Holy Champion. Holy Champion does allow him to have a minion that his opponent has to do something against.
And this also almost forces like a double trade from the Warlock, right? Because he does kill off the Nerubian, and then it's either, well, the Lotheb goes into it, or, you know, more of your minions do.
Yeah, so the Implosion may change that, but we know that Pokrovac has a great answer to even that in his hand right now.
And that's the powerful position he was in last turn, even with the Lotheb saying, you can't AoE down this big board. He's so safe, it's like, well, I'll just AoE down whatever you add next turn.
Right, and people watching might be wondering, you know, he had the chance to play the Orcanai Soul Priest that turn before he traded the Chao, and he'd be able to damage his opponent instead of healing him. You know, why heal your opponent in that situation where you can deal damage? And the reason is, like, the Priest is sitting here as the control deck in this matchup. They're not too concerned about the life total, and what he's looking at right now is that Orcanai Soul Priest is extremely powerful in his hand because of those two Light of the Narus that he has that he can use as removal at some point in the game.
And the Implosion, not huge deal how big of an implosion that is, because I imagine we're going to see... Ooh, that... No, it doesn't really change anything. I imagine we're probably going to see a Light Bomb this turn. It does leave the Imp and one... The Imp Gang boss and one Imp, but that's not a huge threat on the board right now.
Yeah, it also looks like pretty nice food for that Pyromancer next turn.
And also, there's always the sort of half threat of a Cabal Shadow Priest as well, to just steal any low minion you want. You're going to play that Direwolf, it's mine, you know, done. But that is an interesting draw.
Yeah, and Handsome Meccano is pretty interesting, because there are several abilities that could make this game play a little bit differently. Wind Fury on something big. We do see there is, as we said, the Pyromancer or an additional Light Bomb next turn. But a Divine Shield could potentially protect at least one of the bigger minions from Light Bomb.
I've decided how I want this game to end, right? Inanzo Meccano goes down, it gets entombed. Can we see the second holy champion buffed and Wimfjord? That's how I want this game to end.
I also want that to happen. I think that that may happen in some alternate universe.
Yeah, it might be slightly unlikely, I suppose, but you can still dream, right?
I think what there is roughly 0% chance of that happening.
Harsh. Yeah. You're just against fun, Sottle. That's your problem.
I am classically anti-fun. This is a confirmed fact about me.
Oh, so, ooh, two Divine Shields. That's pretty big here because that means that the Pyromancer will not be able to kill even the Juggler with two spells, and Light Bomb doesn't kill either of them.
Yeah. Right. Also, the danger of having the Knife Juggler on the board right now, even if he did have, say, three spells to go with his Pyromancer here and be able to clear this board potentially, as he would be doing that, the Knife Juggler would be throwing knives based off the Imp spawns that can potentially kill his Pyromancer and mess it up.
Yeah, so. I think the Cabal Shadow Priest was actually a huge draw here. Like, he can steal the 2-1 taunt, and the fact that that got taunt is really important because you're going to generate multiple tokens to then continue to battle for the board. And you've got to think, with those trades, a Divine Shield's going to knock off at some point. So then, you know, Wild Pyro next turn is looking really nice.
Yep.
Yeah, and because nothing got Wind Fury there, and because he had such an excellent start, he does have plenty of time at this point still. Having seen the Enhanced Omicano, we'll have an idea about which build of Zoo this is. It's probably the Leeroy-focused version, but without any of these minions being too aggressive right now, I think he'll appreciate that he has the time to commit to the board here.
The heal on the Imp Gang boss is really nice. Just buff it back up to 3, so it requires a bit more of an answer. And probably a direct trade from the Enhanced Omicano, because I feel like with this Juggler, you kind of want to guard this Divine Shield as much as possible. You do lose a bit of board control, but I think the Divine Shield on the Juggler is so important.
Well, I suspect that we may see the attack and then potentially just a flurry of minions trying to trade into the Shadow Priest, potentially with the Divine Shield of the Juggler.
That's true, yeah. If you can get the good juggles, so yeah, that would be really good. Because after all that, you do want to clear the board, right? So if it costs a shield, then that's fine.
There is some danger to playing a bunch of minions before killing the Imp Gang boss, because you could just hit the Imp Gang boss and generate more imps that would make your juggler even less accurate. So
he's going to go ahead and use the Divine Shield here by the looks of things. I mean, it doesn't really make too much of a difference, right? Whether you send the Divine Shield into the Cabal Shadow Priest or whether you send it into the Imp Gang boss. It just kind of shows a commitment at the end to trade with this Cabal Shadow Priest, I think, is what that reveals at the end.
Yeah,
there we go.
Happening.
Picks up a knife, loses the 4-2, so pretty much the same result either way. And he is going to commit the Dark Peddler here. Does he have enough time to pick with the Discover mechanic?
Snaps
like
fire.
He does, yeah.
And this game's actually turned around a bit here. Pokervac was in a pretty dominating position, but Bunnyhopper's been able to establish a difficult-to-deal-with board several turns in a row. The Lothep turn really, really turned things around, forced Pokervac to have a bad turn. And as we were saying earlier, the Priest advantage comes from snowballing that lead, and forcing Pokervac into a turn where he didn't have a strong play really set him back, and now Bunnyhopper is the one who sees the initiative.
Yeah, I think as well, although it was a relatively safe turn for him to have a bad turn with that Lothep, the Zoo managed to snowball after that as well and keep the pressure on, so, you know, the Priest suddenly becomes on the back foot, right?
Yep, and we see the Light Bomb into the Wild Pyromancer plus Light of the Nairo to leave just an Imp on the other side.
Yeah, it's an excellent quasi-board clear, I guess, from Pokervac here, leaving just the 1-1 Imp in play, but that is still 11 potential
damage.
It's actually
nearly lethal.
Yeah. 11 potential damage coming out from Bunnyhopper, and now Dr. Boom is drawn after both Light Bombs have been used.
But Dr. Entomb, it'll be fine.
Wow. Yeah, I mean, it doesn't answer the threat entirely. You know, they invest 7 mana into this, you know, War Golem plus 2 Boombots, and you only deal with the War Golem for 1 mana less. You know, I think that's still an exchange that works out ever so slightly in the other person's favor. So, still works out reasonably here. And with that Leeroy and Soulfire in hand, those Boombots might just end up pushing through the last piece of damage he needs.
Yeah, this is a really big turn for Bunnyhopper here, being able to establish a board that's very difficult for Pokervac to deal with. Killing off that Wild Pyromancer with that Imp also will be huge because he will be able to protect the Boomba.
Well, I really like this sort of dynamic here because, yeah, you naturally just edge towards the Pyro, but then you're like, how much healing can he do next turn?
Right.
Because that thing's going to start stacking up in damage, and he does actually value that above the Pyro, which is actually going to help Pokervac, I believe, because if he does go for the Entomb, he can prop the Boombots now, and then he has things like, he's gone into Flash Heal and another Light of the Narrow to just boost himself back up.
And here, Pokervac must sort of kind of keep in mind the damage potential Bunny Hopper might have here. You don't really expect that much burst from Zoo, but picking up that Soulfire from the Dark Peddler is pretty huge here. Oh, but there's just a bunch of Eon.
Sure. Oh. I think it's definitely possible for you to get a read on that, maybe like Power Overwhelming or Soulfire
right.
at this point, because it was a Dark Peddler card. It's not been played since
right.
it was taken. So you can get the read that's four damage that you have to play around. Can you get the read on the other card being Leeroy? Is anything really given that away at this point? I don't think so.
You can. I think Lighter Than Arrow here is totally reasonable, if
right.
only because it generates the Light Warden that is actually very threatening at this point yeah. with how much he has in hand.
I was wondering whether Pokrovac was thinking, what about next turn if I just got out? Can
yeah.
I flash shield
well,
Light of the Narrow and Hero Power? That's like 15, right?
It would be, yeah. If there's a Power Overwhelming, this is potentially 11.
That's 11.
If he
yeah.
finds, well, Power Overwhelming is still.
That's Gormok. That's not going to
no,
do it. He's
going to
be
it.
Sure. And having tapped,
yep.
this is now lethal
yeah.
from the priest.
The Archive Soul Priest plus
the Burst Priest. Oh, my God.
Without Mind Blast as well. What's going on?
Yeah, I mean, this is crazy stuff. All four Burst Healing cards are in this list, which
yeah.
is not something that I've seen. You know, I was surprised when the list was pushed up to three. Like,
yeah.
I'd seen, like, two Flash Heals, two Light of the Narus, but then when it became two and one, popularized by Zet a lot mostly, I believe, I was very surprised that was a list that worked. But the choice of all four is going to pay out really big here from
yeah,
Pokrovac.
Look at him. He's just like, I know what to do.
Bunny
Hopper is going to have no idea what
he's
doing right
oh,
now.
Oh, there's the reaction.
The furrow of his brow.
Yeah, he's there like, okay, you got me. Oh,
yep.
my God. What a crazy game.
Wow. that's quite the ending to this matchup.
Yeah,
that's quite the end
so
of the series.
Sick, yeah.
Crazy
15
stuff.
15 points of burst damage.
Bunny Hopper sat the whole game, or last few turns at least, with that burst damage of his own built up in his
yeah.
hand. And I'm sure all he was thinking was, you know, can I get enough turns? Can I drag this out? Can
yeah,
I get that power
damage,
overwhelming that I need?
Damage,
yeah,
yeah,
get a last 2 points of chip damage in. I'm sure there was nowhere in his mind that was just like, wait, if I tap here, my opponent's just going to burst me for 15.
Like, oh, dead for 15.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, when you're in that spot, you're just like, okay, I just need to squeak in a little more damage, not I need to stay alive. It's rarely what's in your mind at that point.
Yeah, I mean, congrats to Pokrovac. He will now move through to the winner's side match of Group B to face against Diggin, who was victorious previously over Tards. So we are ready to find out how he feels about that. Pokrovac is standing by with Brodan.
Thank you very much, Saddle. I am standing by with Pokrovac, who won his series against Bunny Hopper. Now, of course, everyone really wants to know, why Priest? It worked out, but specifically, can you talk about what inspired you to play Priest and bring it to a tournament like this?
All right. I was training Priest with 10, and we managed it's really good deck on this meta, which we expect, and I think it is.
Now, you have a lot of history playing card games, even with your father back in a long time. So it seems like in this setting, in this tournament, you're not nervous at all. It feels like it's kind of like home, right? Because you've been doing this for so long.
Yeah, I have a lot of experience with tournaments like this, and I wasn't nervous at all.
Now, going into the winner's match, how confident do you feel going into tomorrow?
I think I have pretty good lineup on Diggin, and yeah, I'm confident.
Do you feel like the players here, now that you've seen everyone's deck, do you feel like you have the lineup that you can just go all the way and win the tournament?
Yeah, I think I have. I think I really manage, I expect meta really well and hit every deck best to this meta, like you what I mean.
Awesome. Well, finally, I mean, you do represent the Czech Republic. It's definitely a strong country. They have other great players like Morari and Aleš that really represent it. Do you have anything you want to say to any fans here to close out the day before we head to the sidebar?
I just want to say hi, Dad.
All right, well, that's sweet. Pokrovac's father and him used to compete in card games all the time, so it's a really awesome experience I think to share. Let's go to the sidebar where TJ Savitz and Nimsh are standing by to wrap up the day and talk about some analysis for that game.
Thank you very much, Dan. What an explosive finish to that last game. Something that it looked on Bunny Hopper's face that he wasn't really expecting it. So first I want to talk with you guys about that Priest deck. Savitz, I'm going to talk to you first. What is the Priest's place in the meta right now, do you think?
Well, most people tend to think that the priest does not have a place in the meta right now. We didn't see any priests last weekend, and I believe he was the only one to bring it here too. It's a little bit of a gamble, because priest has a lot of lopsided matchups. For example, rogue is a disaster. If the other players were bringing a lot of rogues, the priest would be so bad. But that's not the case, and I think that the priest is a really good choice overall for this tournament.
Yeah, and Nimsha, this priest deck is a little bit different than some of the priest decks that we've sort of come to know. There's decks that run just Light of the Naru. There's decks that run Flash Heals. We didn't see any Death Lords in that deck at all. So what do you think of this variation of the priest deck? Now, it's a little bit interesting with all that burst.
Oh yeah, definitely. I think what we've seen was really interesting with the Holy Champion as well. So this is the build specifically crafted by Stansivka and Pokrovac to have an edge versus specific aggro decks. And he positioned himself perfectly. It might not be... the plus in the metagame right now is a bit weird for Priest, but I think in the tournament metagame, when people expect Zoo, Secret Paladin, Patron, makes Priest a very strong pick for specifically Conquest with one ban at least.
Yeah, it's definitely a class that a lot of his opponents were not expecting to see, so their lineups are not especially tailored to be beating Priest.
Yeah, it's sort of a reactive deck, not only in its play, but also in the fact that you can react to what decks your opponents are bringing by bringing Priest and tech it accordingly. So let's move away from the Priest a little bit and take a look at one of the clips from one of the first games of this matchup. I believe it was from game number one, and this was a play that the casters talked about a lot on the desk. It's basically just Pokrovac showing a lot of patience. A lot of players and the casters pointed out that Consecration is a pretty easy move to make here, but Pokrovac really thinks it out and actually decides to go with a different line. So, Nimsh, I'm going to come to you first. Why do you think he held on to the Consecration in this play, and how did it pay off?
All right, so basically it's a standard case where you have an AoE and you might want to throw it away, but on the other hand, you also have to assess what's on the board, how much damage is there, how much potential, and how important is the card in the matchup. So here, Consecration looked really tasty in the very beginning because you'd really like kill almost everything and only leave one spider on board after you attack the other one with the weapon. But on the other hand, he had a way to expand his own board, play a couple of minions to be able to contest what's on the board, and then keep this very important Consecration for the future, maybe for an implosion.
Yeah, and Savitz, also, you mentioned a point earlier where getting the Avenge out that turn with creatures on the board is actually super important. Why is that in a Secret Paladin deck?
It's potentially harmful for him, actually, because of that Mysterious Challenger coming up on turn 6. So in that case, he was playing the Mysterious Challenger in any case on turn 6. And if in case that the Avenge does not get triggered, he kind of wastes a card. He leaves that second Avenge in the deck. He might draw into it on later turn when he doesn't want it. And it's a little bit of a risk, but coming back to the play where he chose to not Consecrate, I think it was a very good move. Consecration is a card that you are guaranteed to get good value from even later on.
Yeah, and we saw that later on in the game, he actually had a Consecration turn where it seemed like Bunny Hopper had made the read based off of that turn that he didn't have the Consecration, and so flooded the board and was punished for it. So that was one of the moves that ended up winning the game for Pokrovac. Let's head over to the second clip. This is actually from game number two. And this was a play that sort of set the pace for the game. We can sort of lay down the context here. Bunny Hopper actually decides on an interesting choice here, and the casters called it a bold choice, to coin out the Dr. Boom. And before this turn, he had actually decided to play a Piloted Shredder instead of coining out something like a Druid of the Claw or an Azure Drake. So with a Frothing Berserker on the board, Savitz, is playing Dr. Boom a little bit too much of a bold choice? Do you think he should have removed it?
It really is. Looking at the hands, it looks like a horrible play. It was a calculated gamble from Bunny Hopper. In case that there was no execute available for Pokrovac, it might have been difficult to remove it efficiently. Maybe the Frothing Berserker would have been forced into running into it. Or in other cases, after the death rattle effect from the death spite, it's possible that the boom bots would have finished off the Frothing. There's a lot of things that could have went differently, but in this case, leaving up the Frothing Berserker was certainly a play that did not work out in the end.
Yeah, and Nimsh, this is one of those matchups where you sort of have to play a little bit, not greedy, but the opposite of greedy as the Druid player. You have to really respect a lot of the tools that Patron Warriors have with Deathbite and with Whirlwind effects, especially when a Frothy Berserker was on the board. Do you agree with Savitz here that this might have been, you know, a little bit of a bold choice to go with the Dr. Boom, leaving the Frothy Berserker on the board?
I do absolutely agree, because this matchup overall is bad for Druids. I think, like, you have to take those high-risk, high-reward plays. And Dr. Boom, at that very moment, was a high-risk play where you hope that, as Savitz mentioned, Frothy Berserker will actually attack into it. There will be no execute, maybe no patron, or you will get really good and solid bombs actually killing the Frothy before anything happens. So you need to look for those risks specifically, because he had Druid of the Claw in his hand and Keeper of the Grove. So if there are patrons afterwards, he still has the tools to maybe deal with patrons if he gets a really solid Dr. Boom.
Yeah, in Bunnyhopper's defense, though, I think that he didn't have a very good alternative play there. So the Dr. Boom, just because of what he had in his hand, was a gamble, but there was no perfect play available.
Yeah, there are some times when you do have the spells to back it up, and you can take those risks knowing that you'll be able to deal with the board no matter what. But his hand was clunky, did have a lot of the creatures in it, so
yeah, absolutely.
Seemed like the right play at the time, and he was sort of punished for it, but there wasn't too many other options, as you guys pointed out. So thank you once again for your insight, guys, and of course all the other analysts that have joined me at the sidebar today. We're going to send it back over to the caster desk to wrap things up, but before we do that, take a look at some highlights from the last match.
Welcome back, guys. Still here on the desk with Raven and Brian Kibler, still trying to come down from that crazy ending to the previous series. But while I attempt to do that, let's take a look at where things stand at the end of day one, starting with the bracket from Group A. As we saw, Dr. Hippie was victorious over Cerezo with some excellent Freeze Mage play, primarily setting up some excellent opportunities. And Nyman was victorious, able to ride that Hunter skill to victory over Nyxlay. Meanwhile, Cerezo and Nyxlay are down in the lower bracket, having to fight for their lives tomorrow.
Yeah, and then on Group B, we had Diggin win over Tars, which was a bit of a crazy set overall. And then we've just had Pokrovac in an even crazier set, beat Bunnyhopper. They're the two guys who are going to advance in the winner's bracket, with Tars versus Bunnyhopper tomorrow in the lower bracket.
Interestingly, that actually sets up a matchup between Pokrovac and Diggin, which is kind of what we just saw in terms of deck matchups. So it's interesting to see if Diggin will be able to prevail where his practice partner could not.
Right, and speaking of matchups for tomorrow, let's just take a quick look at tomorrow's schedule so we can see where we stand. So we will kick things off with the Group A Winners Deciders match between Dr. Hippie and Nyman. That will be for qualification out of the groups. And then following over to the same thing from Group B, Winners Qualification match between Diggin and Pokrovac. And then the lower bracket deciders match, this is players fighting against elimination here. You must win to stay in the tournament. We have Cerezo versus Nyxlay from Group A and Tars versus Bunnyhopper from Group B. Kibler, you've already highlighted your pick. Raven, any of these standing out to you?
I'm just looking forward to Dr. Hippie versus Nyman, actually, just to see how these players, you know, who gets knocked into the lower set, and just the difference in confidence, whereas like Dr. Hippie had a bit of a rough set, actually, I think, overall. Did manage to pull it out of the bag, which was good for him, but it's just going to be a really good match, like Freeze Mage Mirror as well. So
yeah, lots to look forward to, lots of great stories already for today, and still plenty to develop. So thank you guys for watching. You can come see us tomorrow at the same time for the European Winters Championship. In the meantime, take a look at the day one highlights.